This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Know-How is brought to you by CashFly.
This episode of Know-How is brought to you by Wealthfront. Wealthfront is a low-cost, automated investment service that is the most sophisticated way for you to invest your money. Whether you've got millions or you're just starting out, visit Wealthfront.com/know-how to sign up and get your free personalized investment portfolio. That's Wealthfront.com/know-how.
Today on Know-How,
we're going to talk about the FAA's new drone guidelines.
We have basic drone exercises for you.
Oh, and those drone guidelines? Yeah, we found a loophole.
Hi, I'm Alex Skumpel, the director of Know-How. We're here before the show today to inform you that while we were recording this show previously, Padre made some mistakes, and it was so bad that Bryan, our normal co-host, is actually now sitting at the controls pushing the buttons.
So sad. Yeah, so,
glorified button pusher.
Yeah. So just to explain what happened, the man who made the mistakes, Padre, would you like to?
Yes. I would like to apologize first. We made some factual errors because, unfortunately, right now I am at CES, so we had to look into our crystal ball, the future, and we kind of got it wrong. We assumed by now that the FAA wouldn't yet have their permanent policy on unmanned aerial systems, but of course, they do. Now, I will say that most of the segment that you are about to see on the FAA guidelines is dead on. We got the weight right. We got the rules right about flight. What we didn't get right is where you would go for the website. They actually do have a website you can go to, at least they will on the 21st of December. And there is a fee. It's a $5 fee that will be returned to you if you register your craft in a timely fashion. The rest of it is dead on. But again, we do apologize for misleading you. For any of you who may be watching the segment after this without watching this segment and then raging into the wind because, well, yes, we
okay, I think that's enough for you, Padre. Bryan, go ahead and roll the open.
How do you do that? Where do you hit that button? Is it this one? Where is it?
Happy New Year, folks. Over here. Happy New Year.
Hit the... Oh, yes. Oh, there's still rain.
Welcome to Know How. It's the Twitch show where we build, bend, break, and upgrade. I'm Father Robert Ballecer.
And I'm Bryan Burnett.
And for the next as many minutes as we need, we're going to show you some of the projects that we've been geeking out to so that you can take them home and geek out on your own.
That's right. It's a new year.
It's a new year.
And we do what we want.
And we do what we want. And by the way, what we want is drones. Now, we know that there are some people who they get a little drone weary, so you shouldn't watch this show. I don't mean this like go away. I mean, we do have a show that's specifically for you. That's Know How's on Mondays. I will endeavor to never do a drone build on Mondays.
But we do what we're passionate about.
But we do what we're passionate about.
And that, drones, whether you like them or not, drones are coming.
And they're not, they're not going
they're
away.
They're not going away.
They were saying it was going to be a $1 billion industry by the end of 2015. And now we know it was closer to a $3 billion industry. And it's still in its infancy.
It's accelerating at a rate that is pretty insane.
It's insane. So you got to know the tech. And we want you to be able to build them on your own so that you can,
geek out with us.
We can
watch all your crash videos.
Yes.
Because we have plenty of our own.
Yes. But of course, Bryan, at the end of 2015, one of the big stories was that the FAA was going to provide some guidelines for registering a drone. And there was a lot of people on either side of this saying, look, it has to happen. Other people saying, this is stupid. Why should I have to register my drone? They're here. And they're being instituted right now. They're trying to figure them out. I thought it's time for us to talk about them.
Yes. I don't know. I have mixed feelings about it. But, we'll work it out because we've actually found some loopholes.
Yeah, we have. We found a very fun loophole that is actually going to lead to a build. But let's talk about the guidelines themselves. Now, these are not official yet. I mean, these were the recommendations. So the FAA will put these up for comment, and then they're going to make their final recommendations, and we'll see what they have. Yes. We know that according to the guideline recommendations, any craft over 250 grams needs to be registered. And this is the big one. This does make sense because the heavier the craft, the more ability to do damage it has if it hits something.
Yes, and as much as we advocate responsible drone flying, the accidents can happen.
They can happen. Yeah. I mean, a drone will go out of control. It will head into a populated area. Even the people who follow our rules about where they should and should not fly their drones will sometimes find themselves in a situation where they can hurt someone. And you know what? We want to avoid that. So in this sense, I think the FAA has it right. Yeah. Now, let's talk about what that means practically. We've got a scale here that we're going to show you. Let me tear this out so that it's at 0 grams. Okay, so this is our Alien X. This doesn't even have the battery, but this is a typical loadout. The battery is going to add another 100 to 250 grams. Already, with a base configuration, this weighs in at 798 grams.
She's a big girl.
Yeah, so this will be a kilogram by the time you're done outfitting it with FPV, a GoPro camera, and a battery. Or maybe even a kilo and a half.
That's right. And we've got the carbon fiber blades on here, too.
Yeah.
Not that those are much lighter than plastic blades. But.
Precisely. So obviously, anything that's 450 class is going to have to be registered. It's way over 250 grams. And you really should, because you hit someone with 1.5 kilos dropping from 400 feet, that will kill.
Or someone's property. Or
that will really hurt. So, and anyone who's crashed will know how much energy there is in that crash. Oh, because they tend to break arms, right?
Yeah, those arms snap off pretty quick. But I'd much rather snap an arm than a frame. So.
That's true. Or a friend.
It depends on the friend.
Yeah, it depends on the friend. Now, let's look at our little CIMAs. Now, you've seen these. We've got ours.
These are probably my favorite drones that we've ever purchased.
This is not customized because I did a class on drone flying at Aaron Newcomb's Makerspace not too long ago. And so I bought a bunch of these because I was like, I want them to have ones that can crash.
Right. I've customized this one, but you can see all the paint scratches and stuff on it. This thing has been running.
These are the ones that we do demolition derby with.
Yeah, we try to hit
each other.
Exactly. These are just fun. And I think we've hit each other with them, as long as you don't hit someone in the eye.
But if you look at the scale, actually here, so look at this one. This one has no battery, and this is going to weigh in at 72, 73 grams. This doesn't need to be registered. Even yours, which has the battery, so this is ready to fly. That's 91 grams. Again, you wouldn't have to register that. That's ready to fly. Even this one, which does have a battery, and it's a larger version of that craft, it's going to top the scales at 95 grams. Mm-hmm. So if you're buying one of these CIMAs as a trainer, you do not need to register it.
Right. Okay, which makes sense.
That makes sense. But these, I mean, we know these are toys.
Yes. Yeah, they're really fun toys.
They're great toys, and they are great for trainers, but you can't mount a GoPro on this. You can barely mount a Mobius, and even if you mounted a Mobius, you're not going to get
that far. They have FPV versions,
which are not great.
No, not yet. Give them another year or two, I think we'll have something.
This is the smallest craft that we built to date. This is a 230 class. This is designed to be a racer. These are small motors. I wanted to keep it as light as possible. Mm-hmm. It's going to add another 100 grams once you strap in a 4S battery, probably about 750 milliamps. It's designed to carry a GoPro plus an FPV camera. But without all that gear, this is going to weigh in at 364 grams.
Yeah. So that's
even
over.
Without all that stuff, this does need to be registered.
So what do we do, Padre?
Well, we're gonna talk about that a little later because we might have a way for you to enjoy some serious power, even without registering your craft. But now let's talk about what else is inside the FAA guidelines.
Okay.
So the first part is, if it's over 250 grams, you need to register it.
All right.
But then the question becomes, well, what does registration mean?
Is there a fee that I have to pay?
Precisely, all of that.
If I build it myself, does it?
Do I have to go stand in line at the DMV like I'm getting a license?
Yeah, the DMV, the drone
motor vehicles.
We'll work on that acronym.
All right, let's run them over. First, you have to be over 13 to register. And yes, you can be an adult and register for your child, but that would be a very bad idea because anything they do with that drone is now your responsibility.
Right.
So just keep that in mind. Bottom line, if you have someone who's under 13 years old, get them one of these. Let them practice on this until they come of age and can register to their own drone. You will need to have serial numbers attached to your drone. This is funky. Because if you're buying it pre-bought, I could get that. They could have something that's stamped on it. But, I mean, if you're building it on your own, I'm not going to be able to put the number on absolutely everything on the craft.
Right. And there's so many bits and things that break off. that we you have to replace every so often.
Exactly, exactly. So they're going to have to clarify that. We don't know exactly what it means. But you will have a serial number once you register it. What about actually registering that serial number? This I do like what the commission did. They first of all said that the registration should be done via a website or an app. So they get that. Not something you have to write. Not something you have to go to a government office and submit. You don't have to wait in line. They understand that people who are going to fly drones are not going to put up with that. So they say, make it easy. Give them a website that they can go to, put in their information, get themselves that serial number.
Okay, I'm okay with that.
The other thing is, for the cost, they said there's two options. It should be free, or it should be basically free. And by basically free, they mean charge the lowest amount of possible. In fact, they suggested $0.0001, so 1/10 of a cent. Is what they said.
Just make it free then.
Basic, yeah, make it free. That was the commission saying, yeah, if you want to charge something, it should be so insignificant that you wouldn't actually collect anything.
Right, because people are just going to ignore it then.
Right. Right.
People will probably ignore it already, but at least there's a little bit more incentive if it's easy and free to use.
Right. And what we're going to see is this is going to fracture the community. Not in a bad way. There's going to be people who say, this is stupid. I'm not going to register.
Right.
I'll take my chances. There will be others who will do things like deal with the AMA, and we're going to talk about the AMA. It's a great group. I'm actually a member of the AMA. It's the Aeronautical Model Association. I forgot. I always just call them the AMA. It's for people who build models. But I'm sure the AMA is going to say that if you want to be a member, you should be registered. It's a responsible thing to do.
Right, right. Okay? It actually might be a deterrent from people getting into drones, though, too.
All right.
Or
right.
Someone who's trying to build a business of making drones could make it difficult for them.
Yeah, we don't want that. Now, one last bit of advice that the FAA did put into their guidelines, and they said they knew that there's going to be businesses that try to take advantage of this, third parties who say,
we'll register your drones for you.
We'll take care of it. And they said it needs to be set up in such a way to discourage that, because they don't want basically drone bags. They don't want drone bags coming in and taking
D-bags.
Advantage of people who don't know how to register.
Okay.
So that's the FAA guidelines in a nutshell. It's really not that bad once you read it. When you actually look at what they're asking for, it does seem quite reasonable. Now, a lot of us are saying, government should stay out of my life. I understand that, which is why we're doing the loophole later on. But if you're going to be flying a bigger drone that does have the capability to hurt somebody, you know what? This is a good thing.
Yeah, all these sound pretty reasonable. If they can actually bring it to fruition where it is that easy and free, I don't really have an issue with it. But I can also see this being, like you were saying with the loophole, this is going to force different kind of drones are going to become very popular.
Yes.
Like very tiny drones or just drones that are outside of the purview.
I want
to
see the hobby adjust, because the hobby will always adjust. There will always be people like us who are going to say, those are the rules? Okay, well, these are technically in the rules.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's like F1 racing or something like that. Every time there's some sort of, you can't go that fast with this, requirement, and then they find a way around it.
Yeah. This is totally different tech. That's not that thing you said we couldn't use.
Right. So it's kind of brilliant.
So start the F1 racing in the drone field.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's go ahead and move on.
Okay.
In a bit, I want to show a little video that I created with some basic drone exercises, because I know a lot of you have received drones as gifts this holiday season.
It takes fine motor skills.
It does.
I had an advantage of playing video games for the majority of my life, but it is a little bit different and having to try and rewire your brain to figure out the controls.
Right. Oh, off the bat, both of us can offer this. If you are one of these people who were lucky enough to get like a DJI Phantom 3, or maybe even like an Inspire. As your first drone. First of all, awesome. Second thing, don't turn it on.
Don't touch it.
If you've never flown a drone, don't. Leave it in the box, because you are going to break it.
Or if you do, please film it. Because
film it, because we will laugh.
As you go straight into the garage.
Exactly. No, seriously. Those are beautiful craft, and I'm not going to talk down about DJI. I will talk down about some people who end up buying DJI craft, which is people who think they're toys. And we've already established, if you're that heavy, you're not a toy anymore. You can cause serious damage.
Drones don't hurt people. People with drones hurt people.
If you've got one of these craft, leave it in the box and buy one of these. This is a SEMA X5. We have recommended this over and over again. And the reason why we can recommend it is it's cheap. When it's not the Christmas rush, you can buy these for about $25 with the radio. They're also almost indestructible. Have you had to replace any of the props on yours?
No, I haven't.
The only time I replaced a prop is when I wanted to find out if it would fly with half a prop. So I cut half a prop off.
These poor little drones get tortured more than any other toy I've ever played with in my life. But
they're so much fun.
They are.
But the reason why we like them is they have the handling characteristics of a full size.
They do.
So if you want to fly a Phantom,
you can fly them indoors or outdoors.
Indoors, outdoors, with wind, with no wind. You can fly them fast. You can fly them in sort of the training wheel mode. And you get a feel for what you need to do with your fingers in order to make this craft respond properly. Do that. Get so bored with controlling one of these SEMAs before you break your Phantom or your DJI Inspire out of the box, because you're going to save yourself hundreds of dollars.
Yes. Oh, easily. I learned from that experience, Padre. We had a DJI in the studio.
Had. What is the operative word? So we know, this is not just us giving you pious platitudes. From experience, if you take your DJI Phantom or Inspire and decide that you're going to learn on that drone, you will end up breaking that drone.
Poor little guy.
Yeah. All right. Now, what I want to do is I want to go over a few more of the basics. Okay. The first is know your aircraft. This sounds really, really simple, but so many people, again, because they're thinking it's a toy, will just take something out of the box and just power it up and take it to the air. No, don't. Be the anti-geek for this one time. Actually go through the manual, actually look at what the instructions are, see what advanced features your craft might have, and know how to turn them on and off.
That's right, study your craft.
So for example, a magnetometer, a GPS, mm-hmm. A compass, you need all of those, and you need to know what they do, how you calibrate them, how to turn them on and off.
Right, which, you know, it's hard to do sometimes, especially when I first tried flying the DJI. I just wanted to fly it.
Yeah.
And just turn it on and fly it, but you had to, like, sync the GPS, right. Make sure everything was. And the part that got me was that I had to sync the props in a certain order, and I didn't. I tried to fly it, and it.
What you just described is something that most people who are opening up a DJI right now are going to have, which is they don't realize that calibration step. You do that every time you fly.
Yeah.
You calibrate the magnetometer, you calibrate the GPS every single time you turn the craft
That's
on.
That's why I like these guys. You just turn them on and fly.
Right,
no
right.
Big deal.
And if you don't do that, you get flyaways. Just go to YouTube and pipe drone flyaway. Almost every single one of those is because someone didn't calibrate something.
Yeah, it just disappears off into the sunrise.
Oh, yeah. Oh, look, it thinks it should be there. How nice, that's cool.
And then you have to like run out into like the canal to try and catch it before it goes into the water.
Yeah, you could spend an entire day just looking at those videos. Okay, second hit, props off. Remember
props
this.
Off.
We are prime violators of this rule, but don't be stupid like us. Be smart like you should be. Anytime you are going to work on your craft with power, the props should be off. I don't care if you don't think you're going to throttle up, because
right.
If you get an inadvertent throttle up and your hands are anywhere near this body,
oof.
Especially this one, this is using carbon fiber props.
That's going to hurt.
It's not going to mark you. It will cut. It will slice. In fact, carbon fiber, if it breaks, it breaks jagged. And I've seen horrific, horrific accidents, like arms sliced wide open, requiring like 30 stitches.
Okay, well, I'm glad I haven't had that happen. But.
Yeah, so don't do that. Anytime you have to work on your craft with power, it should look like this. The prop should be off. I mm-hmm. know it is a pain to take the props on and off all the time, but just get used to it. It's part of it. Like
yeah.
you wouldn't tinker with your car with the engine on.
No, or you wouldn't work on your motorcycle with the engine on.
Right,
and
right.
Get your hand caught in the chain.
So don't work with your quad when the props are on. Take
right.
them off. It's going to take a couple of minutes, but you'll get used to it, and it's much safer. There have been a couple of times when I've been calibrating my flight controller, and suddenly the motors will just spring live because of, like, of some bad code that I wrote.
Right.
And I'm so happy the props are off, because if they weren't, instead of just going time, the thing would have flipped over on my desk, destroying whatever was there.
Well, how many times have we been playing with the Simos, and I'll like reach for my drone, and I'll accidentally bump into the controller and hit me in the hand?
Right. That's actually the other thing, which is disarm. If you have a disarm on your craft,
yes,
disarm it before you approach it. Unfortunately, the SEMA, the only disarm we have is turning off the remote, and right. most of the time we
don't
do that.
And it won't hurt. It doesn't hurt, but it still catches you off guard.
It's bad practice.
It's very bad practice.
It is very, very bad practice. Yeah, disarm your craft before you approach it. Take the props off before you service it. Here's a big one.
What?
Know the flight rules.
Flight rules.
There are flight rules that you should be following. First, foremost, most important, you yield to all man craft. I don't care what kind of craft it is. It could be a Piper Cub. It could be an ultralight. If there's a person in it, it has the right of way, period. Right.
Okay, that makes sense.
Can we all agree on this?
I 100% agree on that.
Well, Alex is actually a pilot. Alex,
would you yield to a drone? Well,
I'd run it over.
Unless it was big enough.
Yeah.
Two, no craft over 55 pounds. I know there's going to be people who want to build specialty craft. You can't. If you're going to build it over 55 pounds, you need to get a special exemption from the FAA because it's basically a commercial craft. Three.
55 pounds, that would be huge, right?
That's really, really big. Three, and we've been saying this, you don't fly over people, you don't fly over cars, you don't fly over crowds, you don't fly over stadiums, you don't fly over roads, transportation paths.
Airports.
Yes, you essentially have to assume that your drone is going to fall out of the sky at any given time. And when it does, you want it to be able to fall on nice empty ground, not on a person or a car.
That makes sense.
Yeah. Also, don't fly over 400 feet. That's AGL, 400 AGL. Wherever ground is, you can fly 400 feet above ground, not more. You'd be surprised how beautiful a view you can get at 400 feet. You will see a lot of YouTube videos where people are in the clouds. Don't be that guy.
No. Like, I think there was the one where the guy lost signal, and it just kept going straight up.
Yeah. When you start to see the curvature of the Earth, turn back.
Yeah, right?
That's our thing. Don't fly within 5 miles of an airport.
Right.
The rule really is you're supposed to notify the airport, but most airports, especially small ones, they have nothing set up to give you permission. So just make it a general rule. If you're within 5 miles of an airport, your drone doesn't take to the air. And this is one that's kind of controversial. Don't fly beyond line of sight. And what that means, you need to be able to see your craft. Even if you're using FPV goggles, you need to be able to take your goggles off and still see where your craft is.
Right.
If you're flying beyond that, you're flying too far.
Which, that also makes sense to me, because as soon as you can't see your craft, that's when bad things happen.
Bad, very bad.
Yeah.
No, bad things happen. All right, now, next step is, this is a physics thing. You got to figure out momentum and inertia. This is one of the biggest annoyances that you'll see new drone pilots have, where they say, well, I put the stick up, or I put the throttle down, but it kept going up. Well, okay, that's because physics says that if you have this object in motion and I throttle down, there's still residual motion
until
it comes back down. So you need to start feeling, and this is why we're starting start with these small crafts. Start feeling the lag time between input and action, because there will be that lag time. You have to account for that anytime you put a drone into a maneuver.
And once you start getting good at it, you can stop the props at a certain time and watch the momentum flip the drone, and then, you know,
that's the funnest part. When you start making physics your cub.
Yeah, take that, physics.
When you can cut physics anytime you want, that's when drone flying becomes really fun. Also, okay, here's something, and we violated this continuously, but don't do it because you want to be smarter than we
are. Don't be like us.
Don't fly anything with bigger props than 6 inches indoors.
We have to, though. We've got a studio that we show off stuff.
Yeah, but just don't do it. If it's bigger than 6 inches for its prop size, it's not designed to be flown indoors. Don't fly it indoors.
No. And you know what? I think our coworkers would appreciate that.
Yeah.
Because these are loud.
And more than that, it's just not fun. Because if you've got motors that have 6-inch props, you've got way more power than you can ever unleash inside.
Yes.
Yeah, so don't do it. Also, do your drone exercises. These are the things that we recommend.
Put your sweatbands on.
Exactly.
Do your stretches before you start. You know,
exactly.
Flying your drone.
Yeah, which is what we're going to be talking about next. So I'm going to be showing you some of the videos, some of the exercises that I can suggest for beginners. These are things that will teach you the proper way to control your craft. But before we do that, let's go ahead and take a moment to thank the sponsor of this episode of Know How, and it's Wealthfront. Now, at the start of this new year, I've got a challenge for you. Why not take care of your money. Now, I know there's a lot of people who think there's basically two things you can do. You can put it into a savings account and earn very little interest, but you keep it safe, or you could risk it all in that crazy stock market or in some mutual fund that may or may not get you your dividends. Well, no, folks, there is a better way, and that better way is Wealthfront. Now, traditional advisors will charge you huge fees between 1% and 3% of what you've got under their management, plus hidden fees for transactions and changes. I mean, just try to take something out of one of those funds and you're going to find out exactly how much they're going to penalize you. But Wealthfront makes it easy for anyone to access world-class long-term investment management. You can get started investing today at a minimum of just $500. Just try it out. It only takes a few minutes to sign up for an account at Wealthfront.com. And it goes to work right away, monitoring your portfolios around the clock and taking action as soon as an opportunity arises. Oh, I know there are some of you who are thinking, oh, this is day trading. This is that risky stuff. No. This is not jumping your money in and out of a market that may be crazy volatile. This is a managed portfolio. Wealthfront wants to protect your funds, and they want to invest the way you want them to invest for you. We've heard from many Twit fans who have used Wealthfront, and they love how they can diversify their portfolios and buy stocks from in-demand companies like Apple, Amazon, and Facebook, all commission-free. Now, it's transparent and accessible. Those are two things that you really want. You never want to be locked out of your investments, and you never, ever want to be, well, worried that fees will just pop up or that they may have done something with your money that you didn't want them to. You can always view all your accounts in one place, whether they're personal, joint, or retirement. You can also see every trade that Wealthfront makes on your behalf in a dashboard on your desktop or with their mobile app. Their sophisticated investment strategies like tax loss harvesting and direct indexing optimize your after-tax returns while simultaneously lowering your tax bill. No more of this, you get to the end of the year and you're shocked because you didn't take care of capital gains. With Wealthfront, you pay 0.25% a year. That's 25 basis points, zero commissions and no hidden fees. That's less than $5 a month to invest a $30,000 account. There are no additional charges for any of Wealthfront's services. They manage over $2.6 billion in client assets, and it's grown over 20 times in the past 2 years, so obviously they must be doing something right. What are you doing? Why wait? Invest in your future today with Wealthfront. Visit wealthfront.com/knowhow to sign up and get your free personalized investment portfolio. You'll see the customized allocation they recommend for your portfolio, and just for Twit listeners, if you sign up to invest, Wealthfront will manage your first $15,000 entirely free of charge for life. Join the many Twit fans who have seen huge success with Wealthfront and claim your offer today at wealthfront.com/knowhow. And we thank Wealthfront for their support of KnowHow. Hey, Bryan.
Yeah.
You ready to exercise?
I think so.
Got your workout clothes on?
Yeah, this is as good as it's going to get.
Well, folks, if you just got yourself a brand new drone, here's how you work it out. Give it again, because I'm not sure if we have enough of a tail on that for him to cut properly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we thank Wealthfront.
Yeah, so come back to me. 3, 2. And we thank Wealthfront for their support of KnowHow. Hey, Bryan.
Yeah.
You feel workout ready? You got all like.
I got my workout clothes on. Yeah. I've been working out my thumbs, doing my stretch exercises.
Yeah. You're left, right, or am I going? Yeah, left, right, up, down. Yeah,
got it. Let's do it. Let's push it to the limit.
Hey, Alex, go ahead and push that magic button. So, you've bought, built, or been gifted a multi-rotor, remotely piloted aircraft. First up, congratulations. Second up, no matter how big or small your craft, you need to learn the basics of multi-rotor flight. I'm going to leave it up to you to read the appropriate manuals so that you know your craft's own specialized startup procedure. If you have a less advanced drone, this will be as simple as leveling, turning on, and arming your craft.
If you have a more expensive device, you may be required to calibrate the compass, GPS, or other sensors before you fly. Make sure you follow those instructions. Now, assuming that you're ready to fly, let's run you through some exercises that will teach you the basics of controlling your craft. Turn off all GPS, headless, or magnetic heading features. If you can, turn off auto leveling. We want full control of our craft. The reason for this is obvious. We want to be able to safely pilot our craft even when all the pilot assist technology malfunctions. Position yourself so that you are behind your craft with the front of the drone pointed away from you. Now arm your multirotor. On many drones, that requires you to push your throttles all the way down and to the left or right until you hear an arming warning. This means that your controls are live, so only arm when you're actually ready to fly with nobody around your drone. Take a few steps back, then give your drone about 20% throttle. You want to spin up the props, but not take off. If you start to leave the ground, reduce throttle. Look for any uncontrolled vibrations or wobbles that may be indicative of an improperly assembled craft. Now move the right stick forward slightly until you see the craft start to tilt forward. Be gentle, you're just checking input. You don't want to flip your craft. Move the right stick back and see if it rocks back on the rear landing gear. Now move the right stick to the left and to the right, checking to see if the quad leans in that direction. Lastly, move the left stick right and left to see if the craft will rotate in those directions. If any of these inputs fail to cause the expected action, then you need to check your transmitter for reverse channels and your wiring for incorrect connections. If you receive the craft pre-built, go over your manual once again to find out what could be causing the improper outputs. When you're done testing inputs, throttle down and disarm your craft. Get in the habit of doing this every time you approach your multirotor. If you don't, you could nudge the throttle while body parts are in the path of the propellers, and you really want to avoid that. If you're satisfied that your quad will behave the way you think it will, it's time for your first flight. Turn on the auto leveling, but if it's possible, keep off all the other pilot assist features. We're not going to go very far, and we don't want our craft taking off on its own. Spin up the props, then continue to slowly advance the throttle until your craft leaves the ground. If it rises too quickly, back off the throttle, but don't turn off the throttle completely. Remember, the only control you have of your multirotor is by differential thrust of the rotors. If you turn off the throttle, then you no longer have any control of your craft. If you have self-leveling on your controller, it should keep the craft level as it lifts off. If it starts to wobble, oscillate, or careen out of control, chop the throttle to idle, but not off, and allow it to hard land. You can fix your drone. You may not be able to fix what it runs into. Assuming that there were no problems, let the drone rise until it's about 4 feet off the ground. Modulate your throttle to maintain a constant altitude while you use the right stick to hold position. You want to use small, gentle inputs. The easiest way to get into trouble is to continuously overcorrect until your drone departs from controlled flight. You've probably just encountered the first challenge to flying, the ground effect. The prop wash creates a cushion of turbulence near the ground. The bigger the props, the bigger the cushion. As a result, the air near the ground is choppy and unpredictable. You'll get a much smoother ride once you're above that layer. Hover. A lot. Use several battery packs to practice hovering. It's not exciting, but it's important for you to become accustomed to how the craft flies. For example, notice how there's a lag time between control inputs and direction changes. That's all physics. You can vary your altitude, but always keep it low enough so that chopping the throttle won't cause extensive damage. Also note that your quad will be unstable if you try to bring it straight down. That's because it has to fly through the turbulence it's creating as it rotates its props. If you want a smoother flight, always descend while moving away from the center. You should only be practicing three inputs: elevator, aileron, and throttle. The yaw or rudder should be left alone for now. Keep the quad's rear pointed towards you, and don't worry about rotating the craft just yet. Mix up the hovering practice with an occasional landing. Landing sounds easy, but the problem is the aforementioned ground effect. As your quad gets closer to the landing, it will want to hover just a few inches off the ground, even as you reduce throttle. Pick your landing spot, reduce throttle until you hit the ground effect, correct your angle to keep your landing spot, then quickly reduce throttle to drop through. Once you've mastered takeoff, hovering, and landing, it's time to try something more challenging: walking the quad. Find yourself an open stretch of field or a wide, abandoned street. Take off and place your quad in front of you, about 5 feet away. Now start walking and keep your quad at the same distance from you as you walk. You're training your brain to handle multi-vector spatial reasoning. In other words, your brain is figuring out how to adjust the flight of your quad while you are moving. Use several more battery changes to walk your drone. Once you're comfortable with basic movement, practice moving your quad from your left to your right, all the while keeping it within your practice radius. When that becomes easy, practice rotating the quad a complete 360 degrees as quickly as you can, while it's stationary, making sure to manage the throttle to keep altitude. Once walking the quad becomes second nature, it's time to move on to the circle of death. You've been using the throttle, elevator, and aileron in your practice thus far, but we haven't actively rotated the craft while moving. The circle changes that. Take off and position your drone about 10 feet from you. Now, without moving from the spot that you're standing on, start to slowly turn your body while keeping the quad in front of you, with its rear always facing your body. In order to do this, you're going to have to use all four controls. On the right stick, you'll have to move left or right to keep the quad in front of you, and forward and back to keep it a safe distance from your body. On the left stick, you'll need to use the yaw to slowly rotate the craft in order to keep its rear pointed at you, and the throttle to hold your attitude. Start slowly, then pick up the pace as you get accustomed to the control combination. If you start to get overwhelmed, stop your rotation and reset the quad a safe distance before starting again. Follow these simple exercises, and before long, you'll be ready to fly.
Oh, Bryan, there is one more step that we need to recommend for people.
Yeah.
That gave you all the basics, but there is a thing called nose in and nose out. This is important.
Yeah.
We told you to constantly keep the green lights, because that's the rear of the craft, pointed towards you. Because as long as you've got that happening, it means that your controls are all regular, right?
It's so much easier to orient yourself.
Forward is forward, left is right, et cetera, correct?
Right.
The problem is, at some point, you're going to go what's called nose in instead of nose out, and that's when the craft is spun this way, and suddenly your controls on your right side are reversed, and only one of your controls on your left side is reversed.
Yeah, and that's when I get into panic mode.
Right. What we're going to do right now is we're going to walk over to a different set, and we're going to show you how we practice that. We're going to crash a lot so you can laugh at us. So, Bryan, you want to go ahead and take your drone over? Don't fly it!
No problem.
See, I knew you were going to do that. Folks, we're being irresponsible here on Know How. Okay, so what we have here is we have a very simple way for us to show you what nose in, nose out looks like. So don't go yet. I'm going to show you really quickly. I've taken the really touchy drone. This is harder to fly, unfortunately, because the motors are more powerful and there's no hover zone.
And you've taken most of the excess weight
off because we were using it for Demolition Derby. But so this is... Oh.
See, that's what I mean by the accidental throttle.
This is regular flight. And regular flight is actually quite easy because all I have to do is I know that if I wanted to get away from me, I push the stick away from me. If I wanted to go to the left, I push to the left. If I want to go to the right, I push to the right.
Right.
But here's the issue. When I spin this thing around, suddenly... everything is reversed. So if I want to go forward, I go back. If I want to go back, I go forward. If I want to go left, I go right. If I want to go right, I go left. And it is a pain in the butt to keep.
Not easy.
Yeah. And then so what you want to do is you want to practice with that and keep spinning it back and forth until you're comfortable with going nose in, nose out. You want to give it a try?
Well, give it a shot.
So this is regular rotation.
This has been the hardest thing for me to tackle.
Here we go. I'm gonna.
Because your brain just doesn't work that way.
I'm gonna go.
Why?
I'm just gonna step.
All right, no big deal.
All right, good. You're happy?
Can I land though? That's the cool. Oh, geez.
So now here's the thing. This is actually quite easy until you get a distraction. Like I'm starting to mess with Bryan, and suddenly his controls.
Okay.
Which way do you go, Bryan? Where do you go, Bryan?
I'm going back.
Where do you go, Bryan?
I'm just gonna try and land on the table.
Oh, very good job, actually.
I'm trying. It's taking a lot of focus, though.
Yeah. So practice with nose out. That's actually the last exercise I would add.
Yeah.
But only do nose in, nose out once you've done the hover practice, the landing practice, the walking the quad, and the circle of death. Those are easy to do because since the back is always to you, in other words, it's always nose out, the control orientation will always be right. Only after you've got that down do you try nose in, nose out.
This is a key skill to master, as I realized when my drone got pretty far away from me.
It gets turned away.
Couldn't quite see it that well. And then, it got turned around. Yeah. And as I was hoping it was going to come back to me, it was going farther and farther
away. Right, because you're bringing it back, and it's going further because it's nose in.
Right.
There you go. All right, so that's all the training we want to give you for this episode. He loves doing that. But remember, we did promise you that we were going to have a loophole. We found a way for you to have an incredibly powerful craft, one that still can carry cameras, one that can still give you fun to boot, but didn't fall under the FAA's jurisdiction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They're cute little guys.
Cute little guys. So what we came up with is this. This is
I love that thing. This
is actually a 150 class quadcopter. It doesn't look like it, but look at this. So the frame weighs a total of 26 grams. Now imagine this, 26 grams. The frame on our Diatone 250 weighs 252 grams.
Right.
So already that, just the frame alone, is too heavy to qualify
over the
underneath.
Guideline.
Right. But what I want to do is I want to show you a quick part list. We're going to be doing this build in a couple of weeks. I want to give you a chance. If you want a crazy powerful craft that will do FPV, we've got it for about $153 if you've got the transmitter and your battery plant already. The first part, of course, is this Diatone 150 micro FPV frame. It's $10. This measures out at 26 grams. I can actually get this down to about 21 grams if I shave tiny bits. It works.
Yeah.
Remember, when we're dealing with 250 grams, every gram counts. Okay. Now, the next bit are the motors. Now, RTF 1306 3100 kV. We're going to be using 3-inch props on this. The tiny little guys, but they spin so fast, I'm going to be able to get about 250 grams of thrust off of each one of these.
So
or
what's
more,
the power-to-weight ratio?
The power-to-weight ratio with the finished craft is going to be somewhere between 4 and 5 to 1.
Oh, that'll be
right?
fun.
It's going to be nice. It's going to be crazy. This will be just going to do a 2 to 3S battery. So we're going to be running it off of a 3S battery. The next part is a 20-amp Little Bees ESC. These are more expensive than, say, the ones you're going to buy on eBay. The reason why I'm going with these, though, is the weight. These things weigh 4 grams with the wires. They're ridiculously light. We showed them off when we were doing our beer build. They have more than enough power for the motors that we're going to be using.
Yeah.
Plus, if you go to eBay, you can actually buy these parts a lot cheaper, but the ESCs will weigh like 10 grams with the wires versus 4 grams with the wires. Multiply that by 4, that's a big part of your 250 gram budget.
It's adding up.
Yep. Next bit, because it's so small, you can't really fly this like we fly the other ones. When you take off, it's already too small for you to figure out the orientation. So really the only way to fly a 150 is FPV. So we're getting this. This is a micro 5.8 gigahertz transmitter. This will do 200 milliwatts of power. I would suggest this for your FPV. This is not as powerful as some of the other transmitters that we've played with, but most importantly is it fits within our weight budget, which is what we need right about now. I mean, you want to fly FPV, right, Bryan?
That's like the only thing I've ever wanted to do.
Yeah. And the nice thing about this, I think it's about 7 grams or so. I've got the weights here somewhere. I'm not exactly sure where I put them. It's probably under my show treatments. Oh, I'll find it later. Okay, then the next part that we're going to look at is this. This is the 20-gauge of silicone wire. Oh, we're going to need a lot of this. And if you buy it from Ready to Fly Quads, it's going to cost you $139. It will give you a meter of black and a meter of red. That's everything you need to wire up this craft because the frame is going to come with its own power distribution board. It's this super light, super thin thing that also has the battery eliminator circuit. Because we're using these ESCs that don't provide power to the flight controller or the receiver, we'll need the distribution board to do it for us.
That makes sense.
Yeah. Next piece, FPV transmitter doesn't do you much good
Without a camera,
yeah. Which is why we're using this. This is a 600 TVL 170 wide angle lens. It's $10. But what I like about this.
Can you click on one of the other pictures though?
Yeah, this is really, really nice. This matches perfectly with that race transmitter. The whole setup is gonna be about 15 grams. which is ridiculous when you consider what it's going to give you.
It's like a little spy cam.
It is a spy cam. It's actually higher resolution than some of the other cameras we've been using.
Oh, man, I really want to play with this.
Yeah, I know, right? The next piece is you're going to need a JST female connector. We're going to be using smaller batteries on this because it's a smaller craft. We can use smaller batteries.
Right.
And also, here's where it gets interesting. We want to use a light enough battery that also gives enough power. Mm-hmm. If we use our standard batteries, the 1,000 milliamp ones, those are about 100 grams. That's almost half of our weight. Instead, use this. Go to the Zippy 500 milliamp hour 3S35C. That's a high discharge rate, but this thing only weighs about 50 grams.
That is awesome.
It should, by my calculations, even if you're really tooling around, it should give you between 7 and 9 minutes of flight.
I'm totally up for that. Yeah. I would buy like 4 or 5 of those.
Yeah. Now, you can. We will actually have enough weight left over at the end if you wanted to put a 1,000 milliamp hour pack. But then it wouldn't be a Zippy because you're...
Yeah, that weight would definitely come as a consequence.
Yeah. And of course, we need props, so I would suggest 3x3s because this is a powerful motor. We actually are spending some of our weight budget on more powerful motors. Mm-hmm. Ready-to-fly 3x3 fiberglass composite props. These are one you 368. Just keep scrolling down. Actually, they're not listed there. Oh, there they are, 3x3. Composite props. So a set of four will cost you $3.68. So altogether, as we've spec'd it out right now, minus the flight controller, because I still haven't decided what flight controller I want to use, maybe the flip, it's going to cost about $153. Add the flight controller, about $170.
Right.
If I went on eBay, I could probably knock about $50 off the total price.
Yeah.
But I will get heavier components. So just keep that.
So just do you have a calculation of what your overall weight is going to be at with these components?
In this configuration, including saving 20 grams for the flight controller, I will run 200 grams.
Okay, so that's still
grams underneath the FAA guidelines.
Gives you some wiggle room.
It gives me an FPV racing quad.
Yeah. No, I'm really looking forward to playing with this.
You down with this?
Yeah.
Okay. So folks, if you want to follow along, that's my list. We're going to make sure it goes up on the show page. We're going to make sure that you got the links. I'm also going to give you some alternates. If you don't have the much cash, I will link you over to the eBay page of some of these products. I can't vouch for the quality. I know they weigh a little bit more. So again, it's sort of a buyer beware situation. But the assembly instructions are going to be the same. And I can't wait for this. This is going to be the leanest craft we've ever built.
Yeah, no, I'm getting excited about it too because I've always... Like, I've loved the Sima, but I've always wanted, you know, once you get good at this, you want just a little bit more power and stuff. Yep. And it was like the 250 was that for me, and the 450 was a lot of fun, too. But, like, if I could get something this size or smaller with FPV that is zippy.
That's exactly what we're going to do.
Yes.
Speaking of what we're going to do, we wanted to leave you with a little something. Here's a minute and a half of some FPV Zen. For those people who are on the fence about whether or not they want to build an FPV flyer, here's what one of the best in the world, Schizo FPV, can do with his. Now, Bryan.
Yeah.
Wait. This is...
Whoa!
Come on!
I do not understand how he's even able to do that.
I mean, this is so much practice. Because remember, you can't control your craft going down. You can only control it going up unless you flip it. So that's why there's all these
free
maneuvers.
Fall. That is so cool.
This is like poetry in motion.
I think, though, if you're someone who is getting sick by just watching this, maybe you shouldn't fly FPV.
But, I mean, he's just throwing rolls in here like they're nothing.
Yeah.
It takes me forever to build up the courage to flip my grab.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Oh, look at that. Oh, it's all...
That was cool.
That's crazy. And these are some of the best in the world, and they all know that this is an incredible run.
The dropping from the ceiling down through the piping, and then not even like he doesn't go all the way down to the floor, he just throws it through.
He knows exactly where to throw the thrust to get through.
It's insane.
Oh, wait. Here's my favorite part. This is why every person is going to go through this at some point as you're doing your acrobatics. Yes. See, even the best in the world.
Yeah.
Even the best in the world are going to crash.
But still.
So that's Schizo. Go to youtube.com/schizofpv. Tell them that we sent you. Tell them that you watched them on Know How, because you know, I'd love to have them on a show.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
Show them some of the secrets.
Jeez. Or I just want to look at his quad, too.
All right. Well, folks, that's all the time we have for this episode of Know How. You know, thank you again for watching. I know this is the new year. This is our build heavy episode.
Yep.
We're going to be back next Monday with, well, I got a little something special for you. You know, for those people who aren't into the build, we've got something a little softer, something that's going to help you in your daily tech life.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah. But until then, what they should do, Bryan, is they should probably go to our show page to find all our notes and our links.
That's right, because everything you listed today, along with the prices, will be there. And that's at twit.tv/KH. And not only when you go there to check out the show notes, you can subscribe, download episodes. You'll probably want to download the exercise videos that we'll come up with later. And that's not the only place you can interact with us.
No, you can find us on the Plus, the Google Plus. Go to Google Plus and look for the Know How group. Join 9,500 people in one of the most active group at Twit TV. It's a great place to post pictures of your projects so that we can include them in our shows, ask questions, or give answers to the people who maybe are building something that you have a little bit of experience with. It is part of the fun of being a builder and a maker to help people who are up and coming.
And I would like to throw the challenge out there. If you think you can build a better 150 FPV quad, you go ahead and try.
Prove us wrong. Yeah. Prove us wrong. That's not a brag. We're going to build the best. We're saying, if you've got a better setup, throw it to us. That'd be awesome.
And then we'll have a racing league.
And then we'll beat you.
Yeah, exactly.
What? Also, don't forget that you can find us on the Twitters if you're not big into the Google Plus group. You can find me at twitter.com/PadreSJ.
And I am @Cranky_Hippo.
And you can find our director, Alex Gumpel, at ANELF3. That's ANELF3.
And we'll be flying... No, we won't be flying our quads into his airplane. He only flies Cessnas.
You know what? We could fly the 150s inside the Cessna.
That's totally possible.
That's quadception. How about that?
Propellerception.
That's like worse than a bee flying around.
Is this bugging you, Alex?
Again, happy new year and welcome to the new know-how. We have so much planned. Please spread the word. Folks, we can't tell you enough. We will tell you every single episode. If you like know-how, if you like what we do, please share it with your friends, share it with your family, post it to Facebook, post it to Twitter, post it to Google+. Get the word out, because we like what we do and we want to expand it even beyond two shows. And if we can get enough of an audience, that's exactly what Twit will let us do.
Exactly.
Yeah. Until next time, I'm Father Robert Ballecer.
And I'm Bryan Burnett.
And now that you know how,
go build it. Or quadception it.